briefly describe what is mixed method research and then some assumption about the resources that is needed in different projects. Then, when to use mixed method research, I'll give you some examples from a colleague of mine that I find it very useful. And what are the basic components, philosophical assumptions of mixed method research? And then some mixed method designs and the criteria for choosing a given design, when to use qualitative first, quantitative first, qualitative after, and so on, and some standards for evaluation in a brief perspective, because this webinar is not so long. So what is the core idea of mixed methods research? Basically, you have quantitative data. In most of your projects, independently of the project, you have quantitative data. Numbers, you get the numbers, the age of someone, but also you have qualitative data. You have opinions, you have basically interviews, and so in the middle of this, you have exactly mixed methods research. If you really have quantitative data, qualitative data, and in your research you need to mix them, typically you need some kind of mixed methods research. So mixed methods research. In order to enter mixed methods research, first, if you are a quantitative methods research person, you need to know that qualitative is also legitimate. Basically, you need to know what kind of research is made in qualitative research. You need to have knowledge of qualitative research. Also, you need to have obviously knowledge of quantitative research. And you need to know that methodology evolves and you have a diversity in methodologies that may be used. And also, one of the things you need to know is when quantitative and qualitative is inadequate and when each kind of research method is adequate. So when quantitative is not adequate and when qualitative is not adequate for your research. These are some examples from a colleague of mine explaining when mixed methods research is needed. I'll try to, since this started a little bit later, try to get some examples, not all that I have on the slides, but starting, imagine that we are measuring a concept on an instrument and you have a sense that the scores, the numbers are not telling you the entire story. Okay, and then you ask a few people about the concept and you get some insights, you get a better understanding. Okay, you have lots of numbers, lots of very interesting numbers, but okay, well, what these numbers mean? What I'm going to do with numbers? And just by talking to someone, you get a deeper understanding of what is the concept. Then, okay, mixed method research, it's interesting because it can provide you with a more complete understanding of the research problem than either quantitative or qualitative alone. Okay, this is the main issue about using mixed method research. If the numbers tell you exactly what is going on, excellent. If you can just talk with someone 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and you get the complete pictures, you don't need numbers because you know exactly what's going on. Okay, so use quantitative, use qualitative. But in this concept, okay, and basically you need mixed methods research. That's the main point of it. Other interesting examples. If you look over some instruments available to study concepts and you develop different sample population than the one you are studying, and then you consider that you'll need to develop an instrument before you can administer it to your sample. Okay, you can use mixed methods research for this, for developing better and mostly more context-specific instruments. There are lots of other examples. Let me just get one or two. If you are trying to predict a concept based on several instruments, and although you have general information about the importance of predictors and so on, But you can only guess as what explains why the results occurred. Then you need to explain how the results occurred. And if you need to explain, probably you need to use some qualitative research, because interviews and talking to people that are involved and so on can help you to explain the results, can help you to explain how the mechanisms work in this type of casual models. Okay, probably I'll skip the rest of the examples and go on to other things. So, basic components of mixed method research. Mixed method research is a methodology for conducting research that involves, at the first point, to correctly collecting data, then analyzing and integrating not only quantitative data, but also qualitative data. And integrating qualitative and quantitative data in a single study or program of research. The purpose is that both paradigms of research, by one side, the qualitative paradigm and the quantitative paradigm of research in combination, can provide you with a better understanding of some kind of research problem or issue that either research approach alone cannot give you very good results. So typically you need quantitative data numbers and analysis of basically a large set of numbers to get you to understand the problem or the research issue. And then you need the texts, you need the video, you need the audio, you need qualitative data and the correct analysis of qualitative data to mix with the quantitative data in order to really understand the solution of the problem, to be able to explain and to answer your research question. So what is the research methodology behind this? Well, we have the entire process of research. Basically research questions, data collection, analysis, interpretation, reporting. And what is quantitative research is that is mostly the focus of this talk. Basically, in quantitative research, and I'm thinking that mostly this talk is intended for people that are now doing mostly qualitative research and want to do mixed methods research. So this talk is in the purpose is that is not the opposite for people that already know quantitative research and are doing now or are thinking about using qualitative research. And so in quantitative research, you have a research approach that involves, by one side, variables. You have lots of variables that may be of different types. You have typical hypotheses and questions. You have instruments, typically not open-ended questions, but closed-ended questions, in which the answers are from a given set of possible values, reliability and validity. How you analyze the data? Mostly about statistical analysis. Obviously, simple statistical analysis, but then inferential statistics, you do correlations between the variables, you do analysis of the difference between groups, and you prove statistically that, for example, a given group that use this system is different from the other group that didn't use the system statistically with numbers. And general visibility, replicability, control, lack of bias, and so on. In qualitative research, as probably most of you know, you have broad general questions, you have the views of the participants, description of teams, interpretation, and so on. More flexible structure that may be used flexibly but correctly, and so on. Comparing these two approaches, basically, when you get quantitative data, you have instruments, checklists, records, numbers, and you have statistical analysis and so on. When you have qualitative data, you have interviews, observations described in qualitative terms, documents, audiovisual materials like texts, video, sound, and so on. Analyzing this kind of data, in what concerns quantitative data analysis, basically use statistical analysis. There are thousands of methods to use statistical analysis. It depends. If we have five persons that answered some kind of questionnaire, for example, probably you cannot use the parametrical method. You have to use non-parametrical statistical methods. If you have a large sample, you can use other kinds of methods. So it's just really a large area. But again, using an appropriate quantitative analysis software, for example, SPSS, or then if you want to do more complex analysis, if you use, for example, a data mining software, really to mine your data and to get meaningful information, meaningful data from your meaningful conclusions from your data, then you have lots of interesting softwares like RapidMiner and RWEC and other software that I'm going to speak about. You have numbers. Typically, you try to compare groups. You try to relate variables. For example, you have a sample. You have 100 people that did something, and 50 of them were men and 50 were women. Okay, let's see if there is a difference between men and women in the way they did something. Okay, and you have lots of statistical methods to do that, and that's quite interesting. And you really can statistically prove that the behavior of men is different from the behavior of women doing something. Okay, that's quite interesting. When you use qualitative analysis, basically you use text, images, video. You are based on coding, on team development, on trying to relating teams, but not in a quantitative way. So mixing the data. Basically, we have to converge data. In most of our projects, independently of they are quantitative or a qualitative project, basically we have qualitative and quantitative data. And so you have to converge the data into results. And you have to connect the data and to embed the data, basically. And you have lots of ways of doing this. Typically in a single study, you just mix the data from quantitative and qualitative analysis into results, and there are lots of ways. I'm going to speak very briefly about this to finish this introduction. If you have multiple studies, sometimes you just have sometimes a quantitative study, this first one, then a qualitative study, then another qualitative study, then this, the data resulting from this process enters and feeds a final quantitative study at the end. To finish the introduction, you have some mixed methods designs that are using research. Starting with the first one, triangulation of mixed methods research, in which you use both quantitative data and results analysis, and then qualitative data and results analysis, and you basically mix them in interpretation. So you don't use your quantitative analysis for the qualitative analysis. You don't use your qualitative analysis for the quantitative analysis. You just mix both in interpretation. A second possible way of using mixed methods is to embed mixed methods design. And so basically you use a quantitative pretest analysis. And then in a qualitative process, you use the results from your quantitative analysis using a qualitative post-test data and result analysis. The first hypothesis is just start by a quantitative data and result analysis. Then you get results, numbers, analysis, difference between groups, lots of interpretations from the numbers, and then use a qualitative analysis based on that and other data to get the final results. And again, you can use exploratory mixed methods design and start by a qualitative data analysis, and building up on top of that, you use a quantitative data analysis based on the numbers you get for the qualitative data analysis. For example, the numbers of times that you use something, number of times that the word appears, the number of times that something appears, and so on. And then on top of that, use quantitative methods. Okay, so getting to the main part of this presentation, since this is quite short, and the idea is to give you global insight about mixed methods research and mostly how to use some quantitative methods, mostly data mining and knowledge discovery methods for mixing them with qualitative analysis. And so getting to the area of knowledge discovery. The motivation for knowledge discovery is basically to access data more quickly and easily, and trying to extract patterns and correlations from massive data. In fact, in current times, we have lots of companies using deep learning, basically using all the data they can. For example, Google is a company that does that a lot. They just get all the data they can into a machine learning system, and then they try to learn some concepts. The idea is that try to know learning algorithms, predict models construction, and see what is data application in different areas. But getting back to my example of Google, some years ago, and it was about 3 years ago, on my slides about intelligent systems, I had phrase that said it's impossible for artificial player or artificial system, a computer, to play the game of Go, because Go is a very complex game. It's a game that is very difficult. It's the game of the genius, and okay, and it was impossible for a computer to play Go. But then, in about 2 years ago, the best human player of Go was defeated by a machine. Why is that? Because that machine was fed with all the data from all the games of Go played in the world during all the years. And it could learn how to play Go. Okay. So the idea of knowledge discovery is that basically you have a concept that you want to teach a system, a machine that you want to discover in your data. In this case, you want to discover how to play Go from all the games played in the world in Go during the last 100 years. And the main idea is that that machine could discover how to play Go and how to defeat the best players in Go in the world. Okay, that's quite interesting, because it was thought impossible 3 years ago, and now it's a solved problem. The main idea is that if you have sufficient data, you can use that data and to extract what is meaningful for them from that data. And sometimes the meaningful things are numbers, are variables of different types. And after that, qualitative analysis is also interesting. So even you can extract everything from the information that is all over the world from a given thing, you can afterwards use your qualitative analysis on top of that, on top of what you discover from all the data in the world from a given point. So, knowledge discovery. This is more in what is typically known in quantitative analysis. And in quantitative analysis, basically, this is the typical knowledge discovery phases. You basically start by having a bunch of data. Typically, structured data for this. It's not like in qualitative analysis. Here, you have structured data. Then you start by a selection phase in which you select the data from your data repository, and you have your target data. After that, you typically use several pre-processing algorithms. Because several times data have, for example, invalid values. You have to remove them for example, data as you can extract some other things easily from the data. And you just run some kind of algorithm in order to get your data and to extract some interesting values from it. Means of something, the max value, the min value, so on. And so you have pre-processed data that you transform into transformed data. And then is the data mining process. There are lots of algorithms, and I'm going to speak about it during the last 20 minutes of this talk, that you can use your pre-processed data in order to get patterns from your data. To see if, for example, this image, I have an image, okay? What is this image? And here you pre-process, you get colors, you get regions, you get lots of things. And after your data mining process, you get if the image is a square, if it is a circle, if it is a triangle, okay? Basically, you get patterns. You get some qualitative data that then you can use for your interpretation using some kind of qualitative analysis. So this kind of analysis is quite useful for getting final data, final information that you can use to generate knowledge. And this can be made together with qualitative analysis. So what kind of data we have? Basically, typically you have data about individuals, subjects or objects that are characterized by variables or attributes. We have two types of variables. Again, variables that are used on quantitative analysis. But in quantitative analysis, we have also qualitative variables. Okay, so nominals, ordinals that are qualitative, for example, small, medium, large. Okay, and we have quantitative variables, rational or in some kind of interval. Variables 3.5, 5.6, or that are an interval, basically, you know, 1 to 5 or 6 to 10 or so. And the first stage is data pre-processing. You have to format your data in a more easily manner to be analyzed. There are lots of techniques. The most known techniques are aggregation and sampling. And in aggregation, basically, you condense your information into more general interests. As an example, instead of working days, you get it in working with months. So, for example, you have the data from your large supermarket. You are not interested in the data of this day. You are interested in the data of the month, and then compare this month with the previous year and so on. So basically, you aggregate your data into more meaningful information. Another technique is sampling. In sampling, you have a representative sample of all the population that allows you to obtain good results with lower computational costs. Instead of getting the data of all your population, users get the data of a representative sample. And there are lots of ways to do this. I'm not going to talk about this now. But and on that representative sample, you can get data and prove that that data is representative for that sample. For example, to predict the results of elections, you do a lot of this. You just get a representative sample of the population of the country. It's not just get the data from Porto or get the data from some city. You get to get a representative sample and then use that sample to infer the results for the general election and see what is going to be the president or the prime minister and so on. Continue with data pre-processing. You have the dimension reduction. Sometimes data sets contain variables that are not useful. And it is important to reduce the number of variables because then the models that are used should use only the main components of the data you have. Sometimes you have data on your data set, on your data, that is not useful. So there are a lot of techniques. Principal component analysis is one of the main techniques for this, in which you can get, you have 10 variables, But in fact, only two variables are useful for the concept you are trying to predict or you are trying to analyze. You gather the data from 10 variables, but probably, for example, where the person lives is not representative to see if he likes bananas. Okay, he likes bananas. Probably the age is useful or not, the sex useful or not, but probably the location useful or not. Okay, so principal component analysis sometimes it uses, and there are lots of techniques that quantitative analysis systems offer you to do this. Variables creation. Basically, you can create new variables from the original data set. In fact, sometimes you have lots of variables, but you can get several variables into a new variable that represent the set of variables you have. An example, sometimes ago we are trying to use data from football, soccer games, in order to, using the positions of the players to predict or to say what was the formation of the team. If it was a 4-3-3 or a 4-4-2, what was the formation of the team in the field? And then you can get the positions of all the players and get, for example, the center of mass of the team. And then that helps you a lot on predicting which is the formation, because you have where the team is based, which where exactly is the center of the team. And so there are lots of ways of doing this. It's just a very simple example. So you can use your variables to create new variables from the original ones that help you to describe or to analyze the concept that you are interested in. Another concept is discretization. In fact, several algorithms require qualitative variables and transform continuous to discrete variables. That is not difficult also. You may define intervals, lots of algorithms to do discretization of quantitative to qualitative variables. Typically for people that are doing research on qualitative matters, this is quite useful. Transformation. Transformation is applied to all values in a variable. Sometimes one of the most useful transformations is normalization. Because it's very difficult to compare things that are on different scales. Imagine that you are comparing the grades of students, and you have the grades of the student in Portugal, one has 18 and the other has 12. Or one has 18, the other has 16. The difference is 2. But then you have the students in Poland, and one has 4.5 and the other has 4. The difference is 0.5. But the scale is different, because one of the scales is 0 to 5 and the other is 0 to 20. So basically you have to apply normalization in order to be able to compare this. So this is very useful for analyzing this kind of values. And there are lots of other normalizations more complex than this. This is just an example, basically, but lots of different examples, a lot more complex. So, going to data mining, that is the main of this talk, what are the problems and tasks of data mining? Basically, we have predictive and descriptive classification and regression. Predictive, we want to predict a value based on the values of other variables. For example, you have all the things you sell, all the sales of your store. You have, for example, a store that sells clothes or restaurant or so on. And you want to predict on this given day, tomorrow, in 1 week, how much am I going to sell? How many clients I am going to have on my restaurant? Why this is important? Because knowing that, you will know how many people you have to serve the tables. If you have a supermarket, how many people to put on the registering the products and so on. This is very important to know to predict your value based on the past values. Descriptive, to present data patterns and relations. basically you don't want to predict anything, you just want to relate things. You just want to know that basically the relation of my income on my restaurant, depending on the temperature and on the rain on my area, is this. Okay. And typically there's a relation between temperature, rain, and income. For example, I live in front of the beach, and now looking at the Atlantic Ocean, and there is a large relation between weather and income in regions that are near the sea, for example. And so this is descriptive. And classification and regression, classification. Basically, you want to classify something. For example, you have an image and you want to know, okay, what is this image? Is this Luis Paulo Reis? Okay. Is this a person? Is this a square? Is this a circle? Is this a dog? Whatever. So basically, you want to classify something. You have data, an image, sound, image and sounds, the cells from all the last 10 years, and you want to classify. You have classes, dog, person, square, triangle, whatever, and you want just to classify this on this class. You want to say, this is a dog, this is a person, this is a square, whatever. Okay. And these are typically the data mining problems. So what is a classifier model concerning classification? Basically, in classifier models, a classifier model is a function that for some individual returns a class. Imagine I have a new image. I just show this image to my classifier system and the system says, okay, this is Sonia. This is Luis Paulo, whatever. This is not a person, this is, okay. And so typically this is learned with the supervised techniques. And the main idea is that we use machine learning techniques, basically use supervised techniques. What is this? And what I give to the machine learning system is classified. If I want to classify an image, what I give to the machine learning system that is going to learn how to classify the images is classified image. So I give 1,000 image and I say, in this image, this is a square. This image is a circle. This image is a triangle. And so I give 100, 1,000 in deep learning techniques, 1 billion, okay, whatever. And then the system is able to create a model that any image that I gave afterwards, unknown by the system doesn't ever looked at the image before, the system is able to say, okay, I know what is a square because I have a model of what is a square because I have 1 billion examples of what is a square. And so this is certainly a square. Or it can say, okay, this is a square with 90% probability or probably a circle with 10% probability because it's not exactly a square, round corners. Okay. So this is basically classification using supervised techniques. And this may be very useful in, again, qualitative data analysis. In data mining, learning with unsupervised techniques, you don't have supervised data. That is, you don't have the data that say, this is a square. You just have the data about the square, but it doesn't say it is a square. And so the idea of unsupervised techniques for machine learning is that you find patterns and similarities in the data, but without anyone teaching you. So there is no one saying, this is square, this is Luis Paulo, whatever in this image. Basically, you just get similarities between the data. And so we have some very interesting techniques. Clustering is the main example of this kind of learning. I'm not going to speak a lot about this. And in data mining, what is the general approach to produce a model? Basically, you have your data You have a training set, and from the training set, using some kind of learning algorithm, you learn some kind of model. Then you get the model of what is the data and what it means, and then you can apply the model that is deduction. First is induction. You can apply the model using deduction in a test set. So you use a training set, for example, use 1,000 images to train something, and then you use a test set that are images that were not on the training set, and that you use to apply the model and see if this model that was learned with this set of images may be applying to the other images. And then you can evaluate, for example, if your model, if you learn with 1,000 images, then you test with 100 images and 90% of the images can be recognized. So we have 90% of images recognized, and so we have lots of things for evaluation. There are lots of learning algorithms. I think I will only take about 5 minutes to finish this talk, so I'm going to briefly describe them. And these are the kind of algorithms from decision trees, Bayesian classifiers. And the simple one is nearest neighbor. It's very easy. Nearest neighbor is just basically, if we have an example, and this is the first image here. If we have an example, how to classify this example? Is this a triangle or is this a square? Basically, it depends. If you use nearest neighbor based only on the nearest neighbor, it will be a triangle because the nearest neighbor on this is a triangle. If you use three nearest neighbors, that is, use from the three nearest neighbors, which are the most, basically you have one triangle and two squares. And so we classify this example as a square because we have two squares and only one triangle. Okay, this is the basic algorithm. Then you have neural networks and support vector machines. If you want to do a good project about machine learning and data mining, typically start by using nearest neighbor just to test your model. And then for getting better results, using neural networks and support vector machines, SVMs. Okay, I'm going to skip a little, not this. These are the tools you have. And the most known tools for using data mines are RapidMiner. That is the tool that we typically use for users that are not computer scientists. Other very interesting tools are R. R is a tool that is very difficult to use for people that are not from computer science. And Weka, it's also a very interesting tool developed by an Australian team. But basically, if you want to start, RapidMiner is the correct tool to start. Clustering, I'm going to skip a little bit what are the clusters and clustering analysis. Sonia, how much time I have? It's 5 minutes, right? Or
yes, about 5 minutes. That's okay. If you need a little more time, it's okay.
Okay, so let me skip a little bit to go to the... go a little bit before. If you don't have supervised data, basically, you can use clustering. In clustering, basically, you just associate data that is close. There are lots of algorithms in which you can separate clusters, for example, into three clusters of data. This is A, B, C. Sometimes it's difficult to separate because you have more or less cohesive groups, but not completely separated. Sometimes you have separations very difficult. What are the groups here? So clustering is a very interesting technique. I'm not going to speak about it, and I'm going to go on to okay, let's just skip the clustering and go a little bit for supervised learning. On supervised learning, the first algorithm is nearest neighbor that I already explained. For example, if you have one key nearest neighbor on this example, it will be a triangle. If you have two, it's difficult to say. Okay, probably a triangle because it's close. If you have three, then you have two squares near and only one triangle and so on. You can use this. And this is a very basic algorithm, very easy to train, very easy to use, and that can give very good results in simple problems, sometimes not in complex problems. In artificial neural networks, you typically have an input layer in which you put your variables. So you put here all your variables, and then you have an output layer with the classes. For example, this may be, imagine that there are a distinguished circle and a square. This is a circle, this is a square. So we are trying to distinguish both. You put all your values here, the values from your image. And then typically you have a hidden layer, and then you have a training algorithm in which we try to approach what is going on in the first layer to getting a good result on the output layer. And putting an image that is a square, giving a one in the square and a zero in the non-square. Sports vector machines are very interesting techniques also. Here the idea is to have a linear classifier that may separate groups and may get the best border between groups. Imagine these two groups in which you have these points and these points. You may imagine a border here that separates the groups, but which is the best border? This or this? Okay, so the idea is that basically if you have just a line separator, probably the best one will be this. But the main idea is that you separate, you can have lots of different borders here, this one, this one, this one, which is the best one. The main idea is to decide which is the best border between the groups, lots of different possible borders. And the main idea is to get a border that maximizes the distance to the groups. So basically the samples in the margins are called support vectors, and the main idea is that you can get a border that maximizes this distance between the groups. This is not only linear, this is a simple example, but then you have lots of possible kernels for this, and so the process is quite complex, but I think you can get a general idea from trying to separate the groups. And then, for example, if you have something here, it will be a triangle. And if you have something here, it will be classified as a square. So this is the decision boundaries and margins. I'm going to skip a little bit this and go to the final part of this. I had some examples here, but going to the final part, just to explain sports vector machines. Sports vector machines, in fact, are probably the most interesting algorithm for this. But in fact, using a correct software, you can use this without having any knowledge of all this mathematics that is going, I'm skipping. Okay, interpretation and evaluation. This is the final part of this. You have then to interpret the results you have. Normally, one of the main ideas is to use cross-validation. In cross-validation, what you get, you have your data and you divide it into K subsets. For example, you divide it into 5 subsets. Then you use, for example, 4 subsets for training and 1 subset for testing your training and seeing what are the results you get in a different in different data that was not used for training the system. Okay, there are lots of interesting systems, but typically cross-validation is always used to test this kind of distance. Another thing that we can use is the learning curve. This learning curve is gets the training set size for different classifiers. Basically, you are going to add the data, the size of the training sets, and then you get the learning grades. The idea is to see how much data you need to learn a given concept. And this learning curve can show you that. And so you can compare different things and so on. If you want to use them, this will be given in the different web miner, in a different seminar. The most interesting tool probably is RapidMiner. It is a tool that is freely available. The environment is quite easy to use. basically, this is divided into the main process, the operators that you can choose, the repository of your data, parameters, and the help. Then it's quite simple to get a given data set and retrieve it to the tool. Basically, it's completely graphical, so you can use it very easily without having good knowledge of data science and so on. Then you can decide, for example, what kind of algorithm you are going to use, for example, decision tree or SVM. Just connect the boxes with the boxes for your data. And then you can also choose the models you are going to use. And after that, this is some ideas and some examples of data that you use for a practical session. But then you can read the data, set rules, define what is a validation method, cross-validation, and so on, and also use boxes for defining what results, what graphics you want, and then you get very easily the final data with lots of graphics and so on. And okay, here, one of the interesting graphics is, for example, the this graphic that shows for each of the classes what is the class that the system says and what are the errors. For example, this one has 17 errors there because it thought that instead of one, it was the 10 class. You can also get the learning curves. Okay, so in fact, you can use this system without having good knowledge of the algorithms, without having good knowledge of data science, and to use that to get your data into more meaningful data and information. For conclusions, I spoke about mixed methods research with emphasis on quantitative research and how data can provide you with more information. I describe you a little bit the important phases of selecting, pre-processing, transforming, and analyzing quantitative data, and some of the algorithms that can be applied is very fastly. And again, as a RapidMiner for an easy tool for you to start doing this kind of knowledge extraction. I hope you have enjoyed this webinar. And if you have any questions, I'll be available to answer them.
Thank you, Luis. If any of our participants has any questions, you can now make them through your microphone or through the chat tool. Thank you for this very synthesized presentation. We will be sending the video of this presentation to all participants. And if Luis wants to send any other materials that may be useful about this theme, we can send them as well tomorrow. In the meantime, if someone wants to throw a question, please do so. Now it's the time.
No probably question. For describing better the use of software and more practical terms, we need another webinar.
Yeah, sure.
We can schedule it in the next few months because basically this was just a brief introduction of the subject. But obviously, a more practical one can be very useful.
For sure. The participants who are here today have some suggestions on possible themes to complete this presentation, you just have to send them to us and we will try to set up another session regarding the use of software on a more practical perspective. Sure. If there are no questions, I think we can call it a day and end this session. Thank you so much for attending. Thank you, Luis, for your presentation. And if you have any questions, please send us an email or follow us on social media or through our website. You can receive all the news through the WebQVA newsletter. But if you have any questions regarding WebQVA, send us through email and we will try to answer it as soon as possible. Thank you very much. We will see you soon. Thank you, Luis.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Take care.
See you soon.
See you soon.